Last few weeks, we have been talking about which gospel, and we presented different views: the holistic gospel, the gospel of Christ, the gospel of grace, the gospel of rest. And today, I want to finish these sessions talking to you about what is another gospel. Paul, in his opening lines to the Galatian church, talks to them about how they have turned to listen to another gospel. And in Galatians 1, verse 6, the Bible says, "I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there are some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. And we said before, so I say now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached, let him be accursed." These are very strong words to the Galatian church, and his concern was that the gospel was being perverted. So it was not really another gospel, but it was the gospel that they had preached, but that was now being perverted. And his condemnation of such that preached a perverted gospel was that they should be accursed or be excommunicated from the church. Now, you have to know what gospel did Paul preach to know what is a perverted gospel or what is another gospel. And the entire book of Galatians, and I would encourage you maybe in this week to read the entire six chapters, you would find how the gospel is very succinctly summarized and captured throughout the book of Galatians. So he speaks of the gospel of grace, the gospel of obedience, the gospel of sonship, the gospel of our liberty. And all of that is a summary of what the gospel that Paul preached. So I just want to touch on a few things. The gospel that Paul preached to the Gentiles was one of faith in Christ Jesus and not justification by the works of the law. So in Galatians 2:16, knowing that a man is not justified by works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Christ Jesus, that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by works of the law. For by the works of the law, no flesh shall be justified. So the works of the law, and if you read the book of Galatians, would include being circumcised. So what he was saying is to the Gentiles who have now received Christ, that the Jews are now forcing you to be circumcised, which is an addition to the gospel. That means you are justified by faith and not by works. And the works was that you are now being persuaded to also be circumcised beyond the fact that you have just accepted Jesus Christ by faith into your heart. So this is justification by works. So the works of the law include being circumcised and keeping rituals and traditions that are associated with the law. And the Jews were now compelling the Gentiles to not only have faith in Christ, but also to keep the law. And this is what Paul was arguing, that to be saved and justified, you only need to have faith in Christ Jesus and not also keep the works of the law. Jesus faced the same arguments with the Pharisees when his disciples did not practice certain traditions. In Mark chapter 7, verse 5, and the Pharisees and the scribes said, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the traditions of the elders, but eat bread with unwashed hands?" And he answered and said to them, "Isaiah prophesied about you, because people honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me." So it was not about the traditions, it was about whether your heart had really changed. So the argument of keeping the traditions while Jesus Christ, who is the fulfillment of the law, was around, was presented even during Jesus's time. Now, Paul also preached the gospel of sonship. In Galatians 3:26, "For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus." And then he says, "For as many of you that were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ. Jesus. So the Galatian church was receiving another gospel where Gentiles were compelled to behave and become like Jews because they have received the law. Many Christians practice what we call Judaism. They keep days, times, and seasons according to the law. Now, the gospel of sonship removes certain codes in our lives: age code, gender code, race code, social code, all of these codes that sort of put a limitation on who we are really in Christ. So, yeah, Paul is saying you are no longer a Jew. You are no longer Greek, you are no longer a slave, you are no longer free, you are no longer male, you are no longer female, you are now the Son of God. Another gospel is where you are said to be the Son of God, but you are also trying to distinguish yourself by being a Jew or by being a Gentile. This is not to deny who you are in terms of your creation and who you are in terms of your ethnicity or your gender. But when we are in Christ, we are all equal because we are the sons of God. Now, while God did not send his son, who was born as a Jew, to make us Jews, and you need to really understand this because you find a lot of Christians that are practicing Judaism. This is the practice of the feasts of the Jews. This is the practice of the rituals of the Jews. And they sort of feel that by keeping these Jewish customs, they are actually fulfilling what Christ required of them. But God did not send his son to make us Jews. He sent his son because he loved the world. And Jesus did not die to make us Jews. He died so that by faith in him, we could become the sons of God as promised to Abraham. Now, while Israel is a special people, like us, they also have to receive Jesus Christ as their Savior. We who are Gentiles, meaning we are not Jews, are called to be formed into the image and the likeness of Christ, not into the image and the likeness of Jews. So if you go to places like South America, you would find that Judaism is highly practiced. You will find the menorah or the lampstand in the church. You will find certain rituals. You will find the talit, which is the prayer cloth, is quite evident. You will find people dressing up as Jews and practicing a lot of the ritualistic. You will find people wearing priestly garments. All of that is another gospel. It is a perversion of what the true gospel is, and that we are sons of God. Now, Paul also preached the gospel of liberty. In Galatians 5, verse 1 to 2, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ has made us free, and do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Now, this liberty was freedom from the law that requires, as I mentioned, circumcision and the keeping of the whole law. The liberty we have in Christ is that we are free from the curse of the law and the traditions of men. This gospel, as mentioned, is not one of all the codes that we are used to, but it is to set us free and to make us free in Christ. Now, the gospel sets us free from the curse of the law of sin and death and gives us freedom in Christ. This is not, listen carefully, this is not liberalism, which is to live as you please, but it is liberty to live pleasing unto God. So the liberty that we receive in Christ is freedom from the curse of the law and bondage, where there was requirements of offerings, there was requirements of sacrifice, there was requirements of traditions, there was requirements of circumcision. These are called works of the law. We are set free from the works of the law. And this is why we receive liberty, and we are not in bondage to that anymore. But that has been now termed as liberalism, where we feel that we are now free to do whatever we like. In Galatians 5 verse 13, listen carefully to the verse. For you, brethren, have been called to liberty. So we have been called to liberty. Only do not use your liberty as an opportunity for the flesh. And this is where the distinction between liberty and liberalism comes in, where we use our liberty to now satisfy our liberalism in the flesh. The Bible says, but through love, serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Another perversion of the gospel is that we are now free in Christ, and Christ loves us no matter who or what we are. People use their liberty in Christ to fulfill their fleshly desires. The love of Christ causes us to serve one another just as Jesus came to serve us. Now, if we do not know the truth of the gospel, then we become victims of a movement called progressive Christianity. Let me read a quote for you. Progressive Christians view the Bible as primarily a human book. So they do not believe that the book is the inspired word of God. They believe that it is a human book and emphasizes personal conscience and practices rather than certainty and beliefs. They are also very open to redefining, reinterpreting, and even rejecting essential doctrines of faith like the virgin birth, the deity of Jesus, and his bodily resurrection. Now, if you have no understanding of truly what the gospel of liberty is, which is a freedom from the works of the law where you are not in bondage to that anymore, then it's very easy for you to become a progressive Christian and you become a victim of another gospel where everything becomes redefined using the Bible to redefine it. Now, progressive Christians have very strong arguments and very strong critiques even about evangelical Christians. But if you do not know really what the gospel is, which is one of grace, one of sonship, one of salvation, the gospel of Christ, and many other things that we shared with you, and if you do not have the truth abiding in you, it is very easy to become a victim of Judaism. It is very easy to become a victim of progressive Christianity. And this is what we call another gospel. Galatians 5 verse 7 to 8 says, you ran well. This is Paul's address to the Galatian church, to a people that he presented the truth of the gospel to, a people that he spent time explaining the true gospel to. But now, because of the influence of Jews that have come into the region who have perverted the gospel, forcing them to practice Jewish law, the gospel had been perverted. And he said to them, you ran well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? Understand that you can receive the gospel, but you can be hindered from obeying the truth. This persuasion, verse 8 says, does not come from him who calls you. So another gospel, a perverted gospel, a different gospel, will hinder us from obeying the truth. It is a persuasion, or the correct word, it is a deception that does not come from God who calls us. May our eyes be open to what is a different gospel and what is another gospel, so that we do not take what is the truth and allow it to be perverted and cause us to hinder us from obeying the truth. May the true gospel of Christ be found in each of our lives so that we do not follow another gospel. God bless you. Amen.